sponsored by the Securities and Exchange Commission of Nigeria.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Eye on Nigeria's Capital Market. I'm Esther Ugodaga. Nigeria's Securities and Exchange Commission is unrelenting in its efforts to transform the country's capital market into one that will serve as a gateway to others on the African continent. Today, we'll look at the latest efforts by the SEC to further deepen the debt capital market with the help of the International Finance Corporation.
The Nigerian bond market has undergone a number of changes in the last few years, particularly in the areas of depth and liquidity, a development which the majority of analysts agree has put an end to years of stagnated growth.
We're moving from a period when most financial institutions were not able to recognize debt instruments in Nigeria, to a point where even foreign investors are scrambling for Nigerian debt instruments. And what are those factors that have driven the growth of the debt market? One, the activities of the Debt Management Office in creating an enabling environment, the regulations, the monetary policy system of the central bank, which has made fixed income instruments very attractive, and then the strength of the Nigerian economy in terms of oil earnings, rebuilding of the foreign reserve about 48 billion. Those are factors that have created a higher level of confidence in Nigerian debt instruments.
You could talk about the evolution of, or the recent evolution of the debt capital markets in a manner of the different milestones that have happened. Obviously, the very first one is the appointment of the primary dealers and the market maker system, where the first 10 or 12 primary market dealers were appointed. Banks and discount houses. What that did was that it automatically started the evolution of the secondary market trading, where all dealers had obligations to trade and to participate in the primary market auctions. Another key thing that has also helped that quick evolution is the entrance of the foreign portfolio investor, who has also increased the scope and the depth of the debt capital markets through their significant inflows into this market and their interest in Nigerian government debt as a whole.
This steady progress has attracted attention from both international investors and multilateral organizations. And in the last 2 years alone, Nigeria has seen an inflow of over $2.4 billion in foreign capital through the local debt market.
What they bring to the table, apart from their exposure in other markets and the development in other markets, is also bringing or using long-term securities to aid the development of the economy and to help the well-being of the citizens. I think one key area that everybody keeps looking out to in terms of developing Nigeria is, for example, is the area of mortgages. And we all know that mortgages are long-term financing, which is not at this point the preferred investment or the preferred market that most of the banks play in. My view is that this is, for example, one of the key areas that these organizations can help out with. And this would be done based on their experiences elsewhere, where this secondary market for this sort of instruments have been developed, and they've seen the story, they know how it goes, they know how it starts and how it ends.
Despite these achievements, federal government bond issues remain dominant, and the SEC recognizes that more needs to be done. To this end, the regulator and the International Finance Corporation organize a debt capital market conference in partnership with the Pensions Commission to highlight the growth story of the market and plans to deepen it through IFC's investments.
The partnership with the IFC in debt capital markets is very, very critical, because they're a AAA rated issuer, and so when they borrow in a particular market, it attracts investors to that market, because those investors are familiar with their name. You could not find a better partner in trying to think about, now we have an established corporate bond market, an established subnational market.
Nigeria is already the largest investment destination in sub-Saharan Africa for IFC. In the just closed fiscal year 2013, we invested over $1.5 billion, representing about 30% of our total sub-Saharan African investment.
With the SEC, we've had a partnership for the last 3 years. It's been focused around debt capital markets, rejuvenating the debt capital markets. So at one time, we placed a resident advisor in the STC who was supposed to help them change the whole process towards debt capital market issuances. We've really progressed from that point where we as IFC have issued a Naira bond. And you know, it's for dual purposes. We both want to be able to provide Naira financing for our projects in Nigeria, but we also want to support the broader development of the debt capital markets.
For the international lender, access to local currency finance, along with vibrant domestic debt markets, are foundations for long-term private sector development and economic growth.
Our investment is growing, and growing very fast. Whether a big portion of that investment will be denominated in Nigerian Naira or not is a function of how the domestic capital market matures. And we certainly wish that given the appetite, given that the regulatory agencies are very keen to promote local currency capital market development, the market will develop much faster, therefore the percentage of IFC's investment will be denominated in Naira.
Nigeria can take a cue from the role of the debt capital markets in the growth story of developing countries like China.
Compared with Nigeria, I can see that the Chinese market, government played an important role in the process, and governments are really taking a lot of initiatives. Here, it's the market is probably more important force here, and I really want to encourage the government to take more action and to set up institutions. These are institutions, both physical and the institutional, from a legal and social perspective, so that the markets will be able to function like the Western and more mature society. And the government played a very important role. And first of all, allow the private enterprises to play a more important role in the whole economy, and set up a lot of new banking institutions and gradually expand the scope the bank can do in the business, and gradually adopt a lot of westernized policies regarding opening the security market. All these things combined together allow the market to grow very quickly.
The IFC says it will focus on sectors it considers as priority, and also explains how its medium-term NEWTH program will benefit the Nigerian economy.
Our debut issuance cleared the way for us to set up a program. So the program right now is intended to issue up to $1 billion equivalent in local currency. And since the vast majority of our current investment in US dollars, imagine if we can switch 20, 30, or 50% of that investment into local currency, and that would give us a pretty decent pipeline of issuance down the road. The second benefit of our MTN program is that with one approval, it gives IFC the green light to issue a series of Niger bonds. Some of them could be in public bond space, some of it could be in private placement. So depending on the needs of the entrepreneur and the private sector, we could be much more flexible in terms of designing the tenor, the size, and the cash flow structure of the bond. So that flexibility will give us tremendous new menu of instrument when we offer our local clients Naira-based funding.
In the course of the conference, key issues including effective regulation, strengthening institutions, and mortgage financing were debated.
What we've done is bring together people in government, people in the private sector, and that group, as well as other groups, we've leveraged it to try and create an understanding that if you don't have medium to long-term finance, if you don't have capital markets that are world-class, you're not going to have an economy that sustains itself and meets the aspirations of its people. Strengthening institutions for us was critical, starting with ourselves. So there are a number of things that we've done, revamping technology, upgrading our own skills, strengthening the Nigerian Stock Exchange, bringing in new leadership that understands what it means to run exchanges, and some of what you've seen that they've done over the last 2.5 years since they joined, basically makes people understand the value of having professionals run institutions.
From our global experiences working with virtually all the emerging market countries in the world, we have empirical evidence that shows that a country could only achieve its full economic potential when you have, on one hand, a vibrant private sector, on the other hand, a vibrant financial market that would be including very sound and healthy banks, equity capital market, debt capital market, derivative market, commodities market. Only when both markets are fully developed, then you can achieve your full economic potential.
A major highlight of the panel discussions was the subject of housing finance.
You know, and the key to Fannie and Freddie and to their business model was really standardization. That standardization then allowed for a very liquid, a liquid mortgage-backed securities market. And because of the government involvement, that then allowed for global investor acceptance. And you know, right now the debt and mortgages by held overseas by overseas investors of Fannie and Freddie total somewhere between 35% and 40%, and that's even after post crisis.
And what's also very encouraging is on the infrastructure side, which has historically been very much a bank-funded asset class, which then is to some limited degree syndicated to investors. It's now starting to show inroads into more capital market instruments. We had our first rated project bond recently as part of South Africa's new renewable energy program, which is very encouraging. And I think there's a lot of work being done to analyze fund mandates to encourage investors to take up those kind of asset classes.
Although participants agree that a large pool of funds held by institutional investors would dramatically boost the market, pension fund managers express some concerns.
If you talk about housing, if you talk about infrastructure fund, either or infrastructure bonds, one of the issues had to do with the fact that as we speak now, we haven't seen any infrastructure fund in the market. We are already working with about 2 funds, that are meant to come, but so far, nothing. So in spite of the, the investment guidelines that had allowed us, as far back as, 2 years ago, even the recent one, December 2012, that had allowed us to put in 5% of our asset under management in infrastructure fund, utilization of that limit, as we speak, is zero.
Some experts share their thoughts on the prospects and pitfalls of housing finance in Nigeria.
The prospects for housing finance are excellent in Nigeria in the sense that there's a tremendous pent-up demand. There's 160 million people in the country, roughly 32 million households, more or less. Only about 20 to 50,000 mortgages in existence right now. That means the bulk of people in the country have built their houses themselves, by hook or by crook, a bit at a time often, with money from family, and maybe after saving till they're 40, 50 years old, or they've inherited something. The bulk of the housing stock, or at least about half the housing stock in Nigeria, is severely substandard.
One of the constraints you face here in Nigeria is a very high interest rate environment. So a lot of blue chip issuers might not find it interesting to issue paper and issue their credit to PFA. So you need to find something, an asset class where there are issuers that unfortunately have to and are willing to pay high interest rates, and package that and aggregate those exposures in a way that makes sense for the PFAs.
PFAs are professional investors, so as such, they need over time to build a diversified portfolio across different asset classes and across different tenors. So this includes hybrid investments, includes private equity, includes corporate bonds, includes it can include a wide range of products, But in the long run, this practice is not really sustainable. You can't, as a PFA, invest all your funds in FGA bonds or fixed deposits.
Despite the long list of challenges, experts say there is a way out.
Well, I think there are several things that Nigeria can do to kind of improve the housing market. One of them is to, let's say, lower the transaction costs that are associated with buying a home. Another would be to expedite and speed up the whole title transfer process so the marketplace clearly understands, you know, ownership and when that transfer of ownership takes place. I think those are two things that would just really just kind of add a lot more transparency to the housing market.
The experience that we've just had, IFC has had in Mexico, is one example of that. Smaller companies in Mexico, which have no access to credit from banks, are willing to pay top dollar or top peso to get credit from anyone else. And that anyone else is the pension funds. But there's a gap between the companies and the pension funds, which is the absence, or was the absence, of an instrument for that to happen. The Mexican government created the instrument. The instrument is issued by these CKDs, they're called in Mexico. The credit is originated by a manager of that entity. And it all starts working. And once you have pension funds buying an instrument which is backed by private sector credit, in this case SME loans, it's a wedge. I mean, later on they're going to start investing in things like infrastructure and things like housing once interest rates come down locally.
There's some opportunity, and not necessarily in the mortgage side. Over time there's opportunity to create mortgage-backed securities. But there's opportunity like in tolling. Those assets can be packaged as securities. There's opportunity in some of the oil and gas projects where cash flows must be clearly identified for it to be successful here.
Could securitization be a good incentive for pension fund managers to channel their large pool of funds? The SEC says it's already ahead on that. After the break, we'll find out what the regulator has in store.